I've had a thought going through my mind all week and a passage of Scripture going through my mind all week, and I'm not real sure about which direction God's going to go with it this morning, so I just pray that we'll get what God wants us to have. If you go to 1 Samuel, it's in the Old Testament, 1 Samuel chapter number 3. 1 Samuel chapter 3. I want to give you a little background of what's happening here. The nation of Israel is kind of in a little bit of a turmoil. The Jewish people are going to God, away from God, to God, away from God, to God, away from God, stuff like that. And God set up in the book of Exodus and Leviticus and things, He set up the priestly order. There was a group of the tribe of Levi that were assigned as the priest to God's tabernacle, to the temple. Their jobs was to take care of all aspects of the temple worship. They were in charge of setting up the temple, taking down the temple. Who was it I was talking to the other day? I was talking to Bungie the other day, and he had just started reading. He's in a truck now, and so he got the audio Bible. He's not that good a reader. And so he got the audio Bible and listening to the audio Bible, and he was talking about how he listened to Genesis, Exodus, Numbers, Leviticus. And he said, you know, I've never read the Bible before. And he was talking about, he said, you know, those people in Israel, he said, they were the first carnies. And, you know, Bungie was in the carnival and stuff. He said, they set up a tent, they take down a tent. They go to another place, they set up a tent, they take down. And so, you know, in his mind, he could identify with the nation of Israel because for years he was in the carnival, setting up tents, go to another place, setting up a tent, go to another place. And he just thought it was so fascinating how that God specified every single piece of the tent, because just like in those carnivals, every piece has to fit together. There has to be a production. It has to snap along because they only got just a few days to set it up, a few days to tear it down and get to the next place. And so that's what was going on. And then it got into where the priests were. And then some of the priests, just like today, some of the priests weren't doing their job like they were supposed to. And we're just going to concentrate on a couple of two or three of them today. One of them, and I'm sure you've heard the name of Eli. He was the priest in that time period. And his convictions weren't really that strong. And he had a couple of sons, Hophni and Phinehas, who were not godly at all. They were in the priestly order, but they didn't even like God. And we got a lot of people running around today that claim themselves to be Christians or God's servants or even preachers in the pulpits that aren't always doing what they're supposed to be doing. One of the major problems with Eli and Hophni and Phinehas is that when offering time came, there was a specific way that the offerings were supposed to be done. The priests didn't have an inheritance. They didn't have regular jobs. They didn't have retirement and things like that. So God set up for the pastors and the preachers to be taken care of. He set up the offering system, and what they were to do was to bring in the first fruits. They brought in the first of their calves or the first of their sheep or the first of whatever. And they would remove the fat from the beef or whatever. They would remove the fat. That was the first. The choicest piece is the fat was to go toward the offerings to God. Because you guys know, y'all love that way that beef fat smells. And the fatter the piece of meat is, the better the aroma. And that was supposed to be, that was the aroma that was the Bible talks about the sweet smelling savor to God. That was the aroma that was to go up to God. And then they were to put it in a big pot, and it was to be cooked. And the priests were to reach in with the flesh. In the beginning of the system, the priest got the half the breast and the shoulder of whatever, you know, if it was a cow or a sheep or a bird or whatever. Then the sacrificial system changed to, they would put it in the pot and they would begin cooking it. And then they had a three-pronged flesh hook is what it was called. And they would stick that down into the pot and pull up. And whatever they pulled out belonged to the priest. And then the part of the sacrifice would go back to the family that gave it. And part of it would go to the offering to God and whatever. Now this Eli and had a couple of boys, Hophni and Phinehas. And what they would do is they would go around to people and they said, before you cut it up and give it to God, before you offer it to God, before you give your sacrifice, we get the first choice. And so what they would do is, and the Bible will tell you, if you read the first couple of chapters, they'll tell you, if they didn't give it willingly, they would take it. And there's a lot of preachers, ministries, non-profit organizations, I remember my ex-brother-in-law many, many years ago. He was his family or whatever was part of a certain church or denomination, and he got a bill for his tithe. They'd send him. I mean, they didn't care whether he came or not. Just send the money. You know, and sadly enough, there's a lot of ministries around the world today. They don't really care what you do, how you do, or whatever. Just send them the money. I like the Gideons. No, I'm just kidding. No, but seriously, there's a lot of preachers that are in the business for themselves instead of for God, because they want theirs first. And what he was doing is, if they didn't give it willingly, the Bible says that they would take it by force. And what they were doing is they wanted it before it was cooked. Because then what they could do is they could take out the choicest pieces and they could sell it. And they could buy more stuff for themselves. And that was a real problem with God. Two or three reasons. Number one, they were stealing from God. The Bible says, how we rob God? He says, in your tithes and offerings. And so they were stealing from God. Not only were they stealing from God, but they were stealing from the people. And so, pick up in chapter number 3. If you remember back in chapter maybe 1.5 or 2 along in there, Eli was in the temple. Excuse me. Eli was in the temple. Hannah and her husband had gone down. Hannah had a co-wife, I guess you'd call it. He had two wives. One of them could have children. One of them couldn't. The husband really loved the girl that couldn't have any children. And so back then in that culture, in that age, your children were your worth. Your children were your value. If you couldn't have children, then you weren't much more than scum of the earth. You were pretty much worthless, because that was the only job you had, was having kids. And but the, let me see if I can remember what, I think it was, what was the husband's name? Yeah, Elkanah. Elkanah had a wife that was Hannah. That, matter of fact, I taught kids how to remember that. It was Elkanah. But he would he loved Hannah, even though she couldn't have any children. And the Bible says that when the sacrifice time to split it back up, he would give her a worthy portion, the Bible says. In other words, he gave her far more, but this co-wife who could have kids, she was ragging on Hannah all the time and giving her a hard time about, you can't have any children, my husband loves me more than he does you, you're pretty much worthless, we'd just soon have a German Shepherd as have you around, because you're just it's pointless to feed you if you're not going to be productive. I mean, that was the kind of, the Bible says that it vexed her soul. I mean, she gave her a hard time every day. You ever had somebody in your life who every time you saw them, it was just, one of those people. And it was kind of the way, you know, they lived in the same house, they lived in the same community, they married to the same guy, and it was just every single day, it was just, I got to see this woman again. I got to help this woman cook lunch again. Every day I got to hear that yammering just going on and on and on and on. Talks more than the Japanese radio, just yamming, yamming, yamming. God, why don't she shut up? And so she finally got, amen, praise the Lord. Get that out of some of y'all, we'll be doing good. They go to the temple and they go to worship, and Hannah said, I'm not going to go up to worship right now. She said, I got really heavy heart. I got some things on my mind, and I just want to go pray. And she told her husband she wasn't going to eat, she wasn't going to drink, she was going to fast, and she was just going to go talk to God. So here she is one day, she's over in the corner of the temple, and you've got Eli the priest who, you know, he's kind of, one day he's a great preacher and the next day he's a money-hungry fool. And so here's Hannah in the temple that day. It was right after lunchtime. She hadn't eaten. And so here she is. She's down over in the corner in the shadows because she doesn't want to make a scene or anything. She just wants to talk to her God. And so she's, maybe I better get back in the camera. There you go. People are ready.
You stepped away from the camera. I can't see you.
That's the point. So she's, yeah, there you go, come to church. So she's standing over in the corner of the temple, and she's praying. And there's no sound coming out of her mouth. Her eyes are closed. She's possibly crying. And she's just pouring her heart out to God. But somebody looking on that situation doesn't know exactly what's going on. So here comes the preacher to know it all good for nothing. He comes walking in. He looks at her. woman, how long are you going to be drunk? Coming to church drunk. You ought to be ashamed of yourself. And she says, no. She says, I'm not drunk as you think I am. She said, I've got a petition. My heart is heavy. I've got a petition I want to ask of God. Well, what do you want from me? I just want a kid. I just want a child. And, you know, I don't know if Eli believed his prophecy or what, but he said, just go on your way, you're going to have a kid. And so she believed him. She believed that the priest was telling her God's word, which is the way it should be. You know, the priest should be giving God's word, not our words. And so she goes and she leaves and she tells her husband, she says, let's have a party. We're going to have a kid. And he said, works for me. And so, sure enough, 9 months later, bingo, bango, here comes the baby. And Hannah made a promise to God, if you'll give me a child, I'll give it back to you. And so she told her husband after the kid was born, she said, I'm not going back up to the temple to worship until I've weaned the child, and then I'm going to fulfill my promise and I'm going to give the child back to God. So here we are, a few years later, I don't know how long they weaned them out, you know, maybe 3, 4, 5, 10 years, I don't know, however long it takes to wean a child back then. But they weaned it anyway, and she fulfilled her promise. She went to the temple. She presented Samuel to Eli the priest and said, I want him to serve here in the church. I want him to worship here in the church. I want him to be a minister to God here in the church. And that's where we pick up. Number 3, it says, and the child ministered unto the Lord before Eli, and the word of the Lord was precious in those days, and there was no open vision. You know, at times, during certain parts of the Scripture, an angel would reveal the truth to somebody, or God would appear in an angel like He did with Balaam and the donkey, and like He did in other places with Gideon and the threshing floor. But in this particular time, God didn't speak like that. He spoke through the priest, and He spoke through the cloud and the fire and that kind of stuff. And so here there was no open vision. So Samuel, even though he was familiar with church, even though he lived in a church, even though he had been a part of church life every day, he didn't know what the Lord's voice sounded like. He didn't know what God was all about. In America today, we are super religious people. Everybody got religion. Everybody's a Christian. Everybody, but we don't really know. We know a lot about God, but sometimes we don't know God. Sometimes we know about church, but we really don't know the God of the church. And part of that is just like it was in those days, is we see so many people who are supposed to represent God that are fake or full of waste products or stuff like that. And so Samuel here, in verse number 2, and it came to pass when Eli was laid down in his place and his eyes began to wax dim that he could not see. In other words, the fat guy was going blind. If you'll read some other places about a little bit later on, Eli was just sitting around getting fatter and lazier. I mean, that's just, ain't no other way to put it. He was just sitting around raking in the profits from Eli, from Hophni and Phinehas' meals, and he was just kicked back in the temple, just getting fat and lazy. And then he had Samuel there to look after all the work of the temple. And I think it's over in like chapter 7 or somewhere where he fell over and broke his neck because he's so fat he couldn't get up. But you read it, the Bible is really cool stories. And so here, what I want us to see for a few minutes this morning, Eli was laid down in his place and the eyes began to wax dim. And there the lamp of God went out in the temple of the Lord where the ark of God was, and Samuel was laid down to sleep. Now, there was a command back in, I think it's in Leviticus or Deuteronomy somewhere later. When they first started setting up the temple, there was a certain group of people that were supposed to bring pure beaten olive oil into the temple. And the only thing that was for was to keep the lamps burning 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. They were supposed to be burning all the time. Now, since Hophni and Phinehas weren't taking care of the stuff like they were supposed to be doing, Eli was fat and lazy, and he wasn't doing what he was supposed to be doing. And that air the lamp went out right before the lamp went out. Now, I don't know if they let it go out during the daytime or whatever, but I read a couple of other passages that said it was supposed to burn continually. And so what my mind is a little bit later, before the light of God went out, God stopped speaking to Israel after they had denied Him so many times. And I thought about that, and like I said, you can pick out whatever part of this sermon that fits your life. In America, we say this nation was founded on God. Well, there's a lot of things that were done in this nation that God didn't have anything to do with, but the founding fathers did use the Ten Commandments and other stuff. The tribes that were here before, they had the Great Spirit and the Creator and worshiped God and all of that stuff. And so God's always been here. But what I'm seeing is in the last 10, 15 years is trying to take God out of everything. Trying to take the light of God out of everything. Trying to take down the statues of the Ten Commandments. Trying to take Bibles out of schools, prayer out of schools, Bibles out of your workplaces. So right before the lamp of God goes out. In America, if you want to do a little typology comparison here, pretty soon it's going to get to be illegal for us to come to church. You know, it's going to get to be illegal for you to mention the name of God in your workplace unless you're cussing. You know, it's and so right before the light of God goes out, right before the lamp of God goes out in the temple where the ark of God was, and the ark of God was that thing that was set up where the presence of God was, where the mercy seat was and all that kind of stuff. And so there's a lot of typology there, and I'm not going to get into everything today. I just want to kind of give you an overview of what's going on here, and then you can go different directions if you need to. But what I see is the priest was laying down asleep. The light of the gospel was just about out. Samuel didn't know enough about God to carry on the light of the gospel. We've got a lot of ignorant Christians in the world. We've got a lot of people who know about God but don't know anything about God. We've got a lot of people who know, well, that's a church, but they don't have any idea what they do. They know that's the Bible, but they've never read it, like Bungie. You know, I've been around it, but I don't know anything about it. I've never read the thing. You know, and a lot of people who've never read the Bible, they say it's boring. Well, I just told you about a fat guy falling over and breaking his neck and his two kids getting killed on the battlefield. That's a pretty cool mystery story to me. You know, I told about two sons of the preacher, you know, in the temple threatening people and stealing their offering from them. I mean, that's pretty cool stuff. I mean, that's almost like live PD. You know, you know. And so here, so you can picture this now. Eli's asleep, and us fat guys, we snore. And so there's you know, it's going on in the temple. It's probably echoing through those tent walls. And Samuel's laying down to go to sleep. And all of a sudden, in the quietness of the room, dark, because the light's getting dimmer and dimmer, and all of a sudden he hears, Samuel. And so Samuel, being the good kid that he is, he's there at the temple to worship. He's there at the temple to wait on and serve. So he runs over to Eli's room, and he says, yeah, Eli, what did you need? And Eli says, I ain't called you. What are you bothering me for? You know how it is when you wake up in the middle of the night. Well, where am I at? You know. Sitting and you just shake. What? And so Samuel goes back and lays down. And a little bit later he hears, Samuel. And so he jumps back up and he runs back to Eli's room. And Eli, what is it you need? Boy, quit bothering. Go to bed. And so he goes back again. And this time, he goes back in there. Samuel's laying down. And he ain't going to get no sleep. You know how it is on them nights when you got something going on that you can't figure out and you just lay there and you're staring at the ceiling, you know. Every little noise from your neighbor's dogs wakes you up. Poor guys. And so, here it is again. Samuel. And he gets up and he goes to Eli. Now, Sam, you know, I don't know how old Samuel is at this point, but he's probably a smart-aleck teenager. And he goes running in. All right, you old fat guy, I know you called me. Because that priestly respect doesn't go out the window now. But he said, what do you want? And Eli finally goes, oh yeah, I'm the preacher. I tell you what, if you hear the voice again, say, speak, Lord, your servant hears. And so Samuel goes back, and sure enough, because God don't ever stop talking. If he wants you, he's going to keep on talking to you until you listen. You know, some of you sitting in here this morning, God's probably talking to you. You know? And I hope he is. And so the next time he's laying there in the bed, Samuel. And Samuel says, yes, Lord. What can I do for you? Because he didn't know nothing about God. He had never seen him. He never heard him speaking to him. I'll tell you a story. Aaron and I were going to get a trailer. Last night. And we got out there and his Cole's trying to get me, and I told him I'd go with him and help him. I'm going to help him keep the seat warm in the truck. And he asked me if I got to go with him. He wanted to go if I wanted to go on a road trip. I said, as long as I ain't got to do nothing. And so we got in, and he went out and backed up and hooked up to the trailer and everything. We're going out. And just as clear as day, I hear it. Ask him, did he lock the pen? And I've rode with Aaron hundreds of times, and he's always hooked up the trailers like he's supposed to and everything. And nah. Don't worry about it. We get down the road about 3 miles, and Aaron says, oh, crap. I wonder if I did. And he pulls over to the side of the road, and he gets out, and he didn't lock the pen in. The Lord is speaking to me, super spiritual preacher. And I ignored it. How many times has God spoken to you and I, and we ignored it? Rose and I were at a sale the other day. And after we got back in the truck and we were on our way to leaving, she said, I was supposed to invite them to church and I didn't do it. See, the Lord spoke to her. She ignored it. Wonder where Israel would have been had Samuel ignored the voice of God. He didn't understand it. He'd never heard it before. He couldn't explain it. I can't explain to you how I knew Aaron didn't lock the pen in. I didn't see it. He's always locked the pen in. He's been driving trucks for 20 years. He's been hooking up trailers since he was riding sheep out on Melville's property. You know, he's been around trailers and hooking up trucks and stuff. It's second nature to him. But the Lord said, he said, well, how do you know it was the Lord? Well, I can't prove it, but who else would be talking to me in my head? I mean, my uncle the witches put a thing in his head, he said. And I ain't been hanging out with no witches lately, so I retired from the school. But anyway, but this video is going in the trash. But the Lord spoke to me and said, remind him to put the pen in. And I ignored it. That could have been possibly really dangerous. But the Lord said, well, if you stupid preacher ain't going to listen to him, I'll talk to him myself. And so he's going down the road. Oh, man, I forgot to put it. And he pulls off and he gets it done. Rose is going down, I was supposed to invite them to church. And then she prays, that super spiritual, sorry Christian prayer. Lord, if you'll bring them across my path again, I'll do it this time. You know how we do when we fail God. But here he says, and then the Lord called and he answered, and he said, here am I, and he ran to Eli, and he went on down. And I've already told you that story. Verse number 10, and the Lord came and stood as he had at other times and said, Samuel, Samuel. Whee! Glory to God. And he said, speak, for thy servant heareth. And the Lord said to Samuel, and proceeded to tell Samuel what was going to be going on in the nation of Israel over the next... There's going to be this, and there's going to be that, and Eli is going to die, and Hophni and Phinehas is going to get killed in the same day. And if you read the rest of the prophecies, you know how to know if a prophecy is true? If it happens. And so sure enough, long next few chapters, all of that stuff came to pass. Well, Eli asked Samuel the next morning, he said, what did the Lord tell you about? Now, how are you going to explain to this preacher? Well, God told me that you're going to get fat and break your neck and your sons are going to get killed. Not a pleasant message all the time, is it? Sometimes we have to tell people the truth. Sometimes. Then he'd probably be all right. Sometimes God has us tell people things that don't sound very pleasant. For the wages of sin is death. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. You must be born again. Some of the things God has us tell people aren't always pleasant. But that doesn't eliminate our responsibility to tell them. We can tell them with love. We can tell them with compassion. We can tell them with care. But some people don't want to hear you're bad and your righteousness is no good. I don't want to hear people tell me negative things. I don't want to hear people tell me, my hair is gray and my belly's big. I go to the doctor and the first thing he says to me every time I go in there, looks like you need to lose some weight. That's the same thing you said to me for the last 20 years. You ought to get the idea of that. It ain't going to happen. Give it up. Pick on something else. But look at verse number 19 if you're down that way. He said, and Samuel grew, and the Lord was with him, and let none of his words fall to the ground. That just kicked my can. Yesterday, the Lord told me, tell Aaron to fix his pen. I didn't do it. The words fell to the ground. Rose said the Lord told her to invite them people to church. She didn't do it. The words fell to the ground. Sometimes the Lord's speaking to you and me. You ought to do this. You ought to do that. You ought to get saved. You ought to go to church. You ought to give your tithe. You ought to witness to this person. You ought to be nice to this person you don't like. You ought to forgive this person that you can't stand. Sometimes the Lord will tell us things. And sometimes we do it. And then sometimes we let the words fall to the ground. The way I look at it is God's got this whole great big universe to run. And He takes the time to speak to me. I mean, the guy that created everything that has been created, the guy that flung the stars and the moon into space, the guy that came to be born of a virgin, live in a stable, grow up in Israel, and die on a cross and raise from the dead. And he did all of this stuff just for me. And I ain't got time to listen to him. You know, it's like Rose and I, we've been married 39 years. Sometimes she don't listen to me. I mean, I do everything I possibly can. I mean, I get up in the morning, first thing I do is, okay, what can I do for Rose today? You know, I go to bed at night, and what else can I do for her before she falls asleep? And then sometimes I speak to her, she don't even listen. You know, but look how much more God has done for us than I've ever done for Rose. You know, it was kind of neat. She doesn't ever let me get in to the Thanksgiving dinner because that's church. I'm just going to church. You stay out of it. Last night I'm sitting at my desk and I'm going over stuff, and she comes and I love turkey heart or chicken heart or whatever. And she comes out of the kitchen, walks all the way across the living room, and she's got the turkey heart in her hand, and she brings over and she pops it in my mouth. She did that for me. Some of you are sitting there going, ah. You don't know what you miss till you eat a turkey heart. But just, I mean, she was busy. She's preparing meals. She's getting the green beans done. She's getting the gravy done. She's getting the turkey done. She's getting God only knows what else she brought today. She's got all of that stuff to do. She doesn't feel good. She's usually in bed by 8. It's already 9. But she stopped and she thought about, he loves turkey heart. I'm going to stop turkey heart. I'm going to stop and I'm going to go give him something just for him. Nobody else in the world has to like it. You know, you think about what God did for us. God stopped the whole universe just to speak to me about a stupid pen. God stopped the universe just to talk to you. God stopped all of eternity just to come down for 33 years and live on this earth and experience the things that you and I experienced. I was thinking about the Vietnam soldiers a while ago and how Jesus came to His people and He died for His people and He gave His life for His people and they spit on Him and they threw stuff at Him and they jerked His beard out and how He gave all of that for His own people and they didn't even appreciate what He did for them. And I was thinking about how God speaks to us and how we just let His words fall to the ground. How God challenges us, speak to this person. Be nice to this person. Forgive this person. Accept this person. Yes, they're different. Yes, they're weird. Yes, they're never going to change. But accept them. Because see, just because something's different don't mean it's wrong. Just because somebody's not just like you doesn't make them wrong. And so you can do what you need to do with this message this morning, but my thing is, when God speaks, we need to listen. And not only do we need to listen, but we need to do something about it. And He said, and Samuel grew, and the Lord was with him. And he let none of his words fall to the ground. Man, what an accusation. Wonder what kind of ministry I could have, what kind of life I could have, if every time the Lord suddenly spoke to me, I would obey it. What if every time the Lord told me to forgive somebody, I said, sure, problem, no problem, Lord. What if every time the Lord said, you know, you need to stop doing this, or you need to start doing this. Wonder what kind of, because the Bible says, and the Lord was with him. You know, I love my new neighbors. They're cool people. I love the fact that they're both military. I love the fact that they're both real. I love the fact that I can hear them fighting down there sometimes. No, I'm just kidding. Sometimes mine and Rose's fights outnumber theirs. You know, but as much as I like our new neighbors, I'd much rather have the Lord with me. As much as I love my wife, I've you know, for 40 years now, I've loved her, I've cherished her, I've waited on her, I've taken care of her, I've abused her, I've done it all. But I'd rather have the Lord with me than her. And it said, if I obey the words of the Lord will hang out with me. You know, I get to hang out with God. There's benefits to hanging out with somebody that can flick the stars into space. There's benefits of hanging out with somebody who paves streets with gold. There's benefits of hanging out with people who can, like the guy dude said a while ago, you know, dying with four stage something and can make it go away. You know, right beside you, he had cancer 2 years ago. He's cancer free. There's benefits of hanging out with God. You know, I love hanging out with you guys. You guys are super cool people. But if it comes to hanging out between you and hanging out with God, I'm going to choose God. Because I'm selfish. I don't know none of y'all that pave streets with gold. I don't know none of y'all that can heal my diseases. I don't know none of y'all that can forgive me of all my past except my kids. I don't know none of y'all that can do things for me that God can do for me. Now, wouldn't it be beneficial to every one of us if we listen to God? Because God says, I'm not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. God don't want you to die in your sin. God don't want you to be miserable. God don't want you to be discouraged. God don't want you to freak out over little stuff. God don't want you to just go all to pieces every time you get a little piece of bad news. Because what He wants is He wants you to know, I'm with you always. I'll never leave you and I'll never forsake you. I don't know. If you didn't get anything out of the sermon, at least you get a free lunch. And all, one more verse, then I'll let you go. And all of Israel, from Dan even to Beersheba, knew that Samuel was established to be a prophet of the Lord. See, when you start following God, it'll show. You don't have to tell folks you're a Christian. You don't have to stand up and proclaim, I'm super Christian. You don't have to run around with your great big family Bible and, you know, walk in and plop it down on your desk at work and say, all right, no more cussing around me. Nobody can cuss except me. I know how some of you are. Especially that big guy with the purple sweater on standing looking at me in the mirror. I know. See, we don't, but God will establish you. You know, God says, be my witness, not go out and witness. If you're really a Christian, you won't have to say a word about it. It'll show. You know? And the Lord appeared again in Shiloh, for the Lord revealed Himself to Samuel in Shiloh by the word of the Lord. God keeps coming. If you listen to Him, God will keep coming back. That's really cool. You know, Rose, she just kept coming back, coming back, coming back. Finally, I said, okay, baby, I'll marry you. I just finally gave in. I quit. I got tired of running. But the Lord, if you keep listening to God, He'll keep coming back. Because He does say, I won't always strive with man. Because I'm not always going to keep fighting with you. See, God will just speak to you just so many times, and then you're done. Like in the truck with me and Aaron the other day, he told me, tell him to check his pen. I didn't do it. Fine, I'll talk to Aaron then. You know, you don't want to listen, I'll talk to him. And that's the way it is in life. You don't want to listen to God? Fine, He'll talk somebody up. Leave you in your misery. You don't have to understand God. You don't have to know all there is to know about God. You don't have to be able to figure God out to trust God. God will show you all of that stuff along the journey. I traded for that Ford pickup I got, 2 months ago? And it would do things that I didn't even know it would do. And every day I'm learning more about it. I've been married to Rose for 39 years, and every day I'm learning more about her. The more you follow God, the more you trust God, the more you know God, the more He'll reveal Himself to you. So if you're, well, I don't know how God does it. I don't know. Give it time. If you could figure God out, you wouldn't need God. If you could explain all that God does, you'd be as smart as God. And you wouldn't need Him. I know some things sometimes feel weird. Especially in this world we're living in. I mean, the headless woman found it wrapped in a blanket. The guy getting shot. You know, I was talking to Robert the other day about he spent some time over in Israel when he was in the army, right? Spent some time over in Israel. You know, and God's chosen people having to live through that stuff. I mean, getting bombed every day in bunkers and hiding and don't know where your next meal's coming from. It just seems weird. But we have to go back a few thousand years when it says, and Jesus came into His own, and His own didn't want Him. You know, God's not going to force His way into our lives. God's not going to make you serve Him. God says, here I am. If you want me, here I am. You know, that's like I told Rose, if you want me, here I am. I ain't going nowhere. Heavenly Father, we thank You so very much for Your Word that never steers us wrong. We thank You, God, for Your Scriptures that won't return void.